Hi, I'm Coach Christian, and today I would like to present the first video of a series of videos on rules. Rules concerning archers and coaches. Since 2012, I've been shooting a lot of field archery, IFAa, and so I got a lot of new students in the field area who are interested in knowing a little more about target archery rules. From the other side, my older students who shoot target, they are getting interested in knowing a little more about field archery rules. That's why this series of videos on rules. If you look around, there are a couple of really big archery associations, international archery associations. Brazil has representatives for two of those big archery associations. They have a representative for World Archery, former FITA, Federação Internacional de Tiro de Arc. Since 2011, they changed the name to WA, World Archery. And World Archery is responsible for target archery, like the Olympic Games, World Cups, Youth Olympic Games, University Games, and many other events. That's a major focus. They have indoor competitions, inclusive world indoor competitions, and then they have also a field section, this field world competition. But the major focus and the major, it's actually the target archery, especially because they take care of the archery part in the Olympic Games. The other international organization which we have a representative here in Brazil is IFAa, International Field Archery Association. IFAa is smaller, they are represented around by 44 countries, 44 to 47 countries are associated to IFAa, being the huge, biggest one is the United States with National Field Archery Association, NFAA, that belongs to IFAa. And IFAa is solely field archer. They have a lot of field archer competitions. They have the Field Archer World Championship, like in Argentina last year, where I was there. Then they have a bow hunter field World Championship. Then they have an indoor World Championship. So, but major is field. That's a big thing. So, this will be the first video, and we will be talking about world archery outdoor target rules from the viewpoint of an archer and a coach. I hope you enjoy it, and also enjoy the next videos to come. Thank you very much. Hi, let's talk about FITA World Archery Target rules. When we talk about target archery, usually we have in mind it's a flat piece of land with targets at fixed distances. And usually for most people, target archery is associated with Olympic Games. And that's a target that people associate with target archery. It's a target phase of 120 centimeters diameter. He has a center, 10 points. He is X. Each color represents two scores. So yellow, it's 10 and 9. Here we have 8 and 7. Blue, it's 6 and 5, black is 4 and 3, and white is 2 and 1 point score. When we talk about target archery, there are two things we need to keep in mind, maybe three things. The first is, when you shoot an arrow, when the arrow leaves the bow, it's called a shot arrow. and you never ever will replace a shot arrow with only one single condition. We will be talking about that. But the rules is a shot arrow is a shot arrow. Once it left your bow, it's considered a shot arrow. Second, the ring we see here belongs to the higher score. So this black line, belongs to the higher ring score. So if you go to 10, we get here this black line belongs to the 10 ring score. This one here belongs to the 9 ring score. So if I shoot an arrow and it hits on this 8 color here, on the red, but touches the black line here, it counts the higher score, because this ring belongs to the higher score. It's just a delimitation to help the archers and the judge to check scores. Here we have an outdoor for the long distances. For the gent distance, it is 90 and 70 meters. This target here, it's a target for 30 meters for recurve archers. Since 2011, in target archery, compound shoots only 50 meters. So, and recurve shoots 4 distances on a FITA round competition. So you have a recurve FITA round competition. You have an Olympic round competition. Olympic round competition, the archer will shoot with a recurve bow on this big target here, and he will shoot 72 arrows. He will shoot a group of 36 arrows, 6 arrows each end, so he will shoot 6 ends of 6 arrows, and then have a small break, and then shoot again 6 ends of 6 arrows, totalizing a total of 72 arrows. That's called Olympic round. Some people call it a double 70. Double 70 round means 2 Olympic rounds and not just 2 times shooting 36 arrows at 70 meters. That's a big mistake that some people make. So Olympic round is 72 arrows at 70 meters. A double 70 means 2 Olympic rounds. At the end, you will end up shooting 144 arrows at 70 meters. A FITA round means you will be shooting 144 arrows at 4 different distances. Each distance, you will be shooting 36 arrows, 6 arrows each round. The gent, male, adult, and juvenile, they shoot in the morning. Usually it's done in one full day, a FITA round. They will be shooting 36 arrows at 90 meters, then small break of around 10, 15, up to half an hour, depends on the organizer of the competition. They will shoot 36 arrows at 70 meters. Then will be a lunch break. And in the afternoon, they will shoot the short distances. Shoot 36 arrows at 50 meters. And nowadays, the target of 50 meters is exactly the same as the target for 30 meters with one additional ring here. So this target of 30 meters, it's 10. This is X, it's 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. And on 50 meters, you shoot on a target that has just one more ring here, it goes up to 5, which is the official target for compound shooters, male and female. After you shot the 50 meters, you will be shooting 36 arrows at 30 meters. This score will be add up for total score, which will give the classification of the archer. It means it will show how well the archer did in and where he will be classified between first and last archer. After this classification round, we will have the elimination round. Elimination round will determine who will be the winner at the end of the competition. So you can have it a classification round, Olympic round style for a curve, or FITA round style on both. Most World Cups are being done on the FITA round style classification. Compound, they have their compound round, which is 72 arrows at 50 meters, which we determined their classification. After done this classification round, you have the elimination rounds, which the first goes against the weakest, the second goes against the second weakest, and it's like wins, goes on, passes on for the next match, until you get the finals for gold and for bronze competitions. The elimination rounds for recurve are a little different than for compound. Compound still shoots at 50 meters elimination rounds, but they will be shooting 15 arrows at point. That means they will shoot 15 arrows in 3 arrows at each time in a 2-minute time. And they will add those scores. And at the end of 15 arrows, the archer with the higher scores win this round and goes on to the next round. On recurve, it works a little different. Recurve, you shoot set system, like 2-for-2 indoor for people who know it, or face to face, similar systems. Each archer shoots also 3 arrows in 2 minutes. And the archer who did the higher score gets 2 points. If there is a tie, each archer gets 1 point. The archer who first makes 6 points wins the match. If there should be a draw, like both archer gets 5 points, there will be a dead arrow. That means each archer will shoot 1 arrow, and the arrow nearest to the center gives the winner. In case that both arrows are exactly the same distance, and that happens quite a lot, I mean it happens more than one would think, then there will be shot a second arrow until it's determined that 1 arrow, you can see it's near the center. Usually after the second arrow you determine the winner. The probability that 2 archers shoot twice exactly the same distance to the center, it's, I myself never saw it. Maybe it happened, but that's really, really rare. But on the first arrow, it does happen quite a bit. On this photo here, we have the big target for long distances, and for 70 meters, it's the Olympic target. Face, here we have a face for 30 meters, and here this face is an indoor face for indoor world archery competitions. And about indoor, we will be talking on another video. So I just would like to show you a couple of videos on target shooting and explain you along with those videos the rules from the point of view of an archer and the point of view of a coach. So when you let's see here. Here we have, wait a minute, oops, there we go. Okay, this is a typical target archery field. Usually those fields are being borrowed by
when someone organizes a competition, since you need quite a space, you need at least 100 meters length, because the longest targets are at 90 meters. After that space, you need an area for security. If an arrow passes over the target or gets through the target on the side of the target, still has enough space, security space, so you will not hit anything. You should not be like have a main road just behind those targets with a lot of cars or people passing by. So it must be certain security. And it must be wide enough to be able to host many archers. So usually you will find a lot of those competitions happening in soccer stadiums or football or cricket stadiums, like the Olympic Championship in London was held in a cricket stadium, places with an infrastructure and which can guarantee security. So it's a plain piece of land where the archer will shoot from one end to the next, and the archer will be in a very flat land. I'm telling this because that's a totally different to a field archery competition. And since we'll be talking on the next videos also on field, just to show the differences. And there are a lot of people don't know about target, they are from a field. So it's quite interesting to see the differences. Target archery is much precision shooting, because you will be shooting, if you do an Olympic round or if you do a compound round, you will be shooting 72 arrows exactly from the same spot. Your foot will be exact at the same position. The target will not move, will not change distance, will be exactly the same place. And so it's all about technique, all about shooting style, capacity, concentration, capacity and letting go and not seeing anything else besides shooting. So you could say target archery is a moment of absolute precision shooting. I would say field is where you have the capacity or the possibility to show how you can apply your technique under the most diverse conditions. And target archery is to show how good and precise you can be under one and similar and equal identical condition. Target archery, wherever you go in the world, will be always the same. So if you do an Olympic round in Brazil, it will be 70 meters, flat piece of land, target size will be 120 centimeters wide, the height of the target is predetermined. So it will be exactly the same conditions if you go to China and do an Olympic round there. Flat, same target, same distance, same conditions of shooting. And wherever in the world you go, it will be the same. The only things which differ in target archery are the distances according to age. And classification. So if you are a male archer adult, you will be shooting the long distances 90 and 70 meters, the short distances 50 and 30. If you are female archer, or you are cadet male archer or master's male archer, you will be shooting the longest distance 70 meters, so you will be shooting 70 and 60, and then you will be shooting 50 and 30 meters. So that will be changed, but the rest will be exactly the same. So this is a field from the back. As you can see, it's a soccer stadium. This was in Cuenca 2008 at 2,800 meters above sea level. It was a fantastic competition. So you have here the targets, different distances. Then you have here support area to keep you equipment, for the archers to keep equipment and to protect the equipment from the from weather, from the elements. Then you have here a space where spectators can be sitting and watching, and they just closed here with a fence. As you can see, it's closed here with a fence to avoid those spectators to pass over to this side. Because this side here and all the other way around the stadium should not be having spectators, because it's a security area. If an arrow just hits the top of a target like here and bounces off, you don't want any spectators here on the back sitting around and watching the archer shooting. It's security measurements. So here we have the shooting line. And that's quite interesting. If you do a target archery competition, you have a shooting line where an archer shoots from here. It must be exactly 70 meters. If let's say an Olympic round, you can have plus minus 10 centimeters difference. 1 foot should be on one side of the line and the other foot should be on the other side. So you cannot shoot with both foot in front of the line or in the behind the line. You must have the line between your 2 foot. Then we have here another line, which is called the 3 meter line. I just told you a couple minutes before that in target archery, FITA field, FITA archery, world archery rules, an arrow that leaves the bow is considered a shot arrow. And you are not allowed to replace that arrow. Well, the one single condition which is different is if you are here standing and your arrow falls off your bow and still falls inside the 3 meter area, at least the knock point of your arrow still touches this 3 meter area, then you are allowed to shoot again. That's the only one condition. In this case, the arrow is considered not have been shot. And this is just to give a chance for an archer who just let his arrow drop on the floor, or like a compound shooter who is trying to put his release on the bow and the release just goes off by not paying much attention. So if the arrow falls inside the 3 meter line, no problem, you can shoot again. If the arrow falls beyond this line, even an inch beyond this line, 1 centimeter beyond this line, it's considered a shot arrow and signs he has not hit the target, you get a miss, 0 points on that target, on that arrow. Each target has a number. It can be on the bottom of the target or on the top. If it's on the top, it must have something around 20 to 25 centimeters space to the top of the face of the target face. And then on top of it, you must have a small flag. The flag is around 1 meter on top of the target. The flag is there to help you to see if there's wind and in which direction the wind is coming. You have marks for distances like here, 30 meters, 50 meters, 60, 70 and 90 meters. And you have a number of the line from where you shoot. The space for each target goes between 2 meters 40 and 2 meters 50. So two targets takes around 5 meters. Each archer has a space of 80 centimeters for him to stand there with his scope and shoot. So you have 3 places to shoot from. So you can have 3 archers shooting at one and the same time at the target. When you have a lot of archers and you are allowed to put 4 archers shooting at 1 target maximum, that means you will then have 2 archers walking up to the shooting line, they will be shooting. It's called AB. So one archer shoots at A, one archer shoots at B position. After those two archers who shot 6 arrows in 4 minutes, that's the time you have to shoot your 6 arrows, get out of the shooting line, the second group of 2 arrows moves in. That's called C and D. The archer A and C will share the same shooting position, and the archer B and D will share the same shooting position. So first 2 archers shoot, and then they move out, and then the next archers shoot, move out, and then all 4 go together to the target to count scores and come back for the next round shooting. So you can have it 4 archers shooting at one target by having A, B, C, D, or you have 3 archers shooting at the same moment, at the same time, at the target. If you have 3 archers shooting at the same moment, it's a lot easier and it's a lot faster as a competition. It doesn't take so long time. So, another thing. So we have the 3-meter line, we have the shooting line, we have this space here, as you can see, it's called press line. It's a press space where a photographer, official photographer of the competition, walks up and down to be able to make photos of the archers. The judges will stand in front of this line. The coaches will stand behind this line. So the coaches stand from here. They are not allowed during competition to walk over to the archers and talk to the archers from the shooting line. Then you have lines at reference lines. Those lines are between 2 targets. So they take 2 targets, a space of 2 targets. It's just a guiding help for the archer, for him not to make a mistake, end up shooting at the wrong butt. See, if you're standing here 70 or 90 meters is quite far away. So if you would not have those guiding lines, the probability that many of the archers would just end up missing and aiming at the wrong target very high. So these lines are a great help during competition. Here we have the equipment line, where the archers keep their equipment. Here, this line is where the coach will stand, and here is the press line, where the press dude walks up and down making photos. Here we have the shooting line. As you can see, shooting line here, the 3-meter line, the number of the targets, and the scopes. The scopes, they cannot be higher than the armpit, so they must be lower than the armpit of the archer. The reason is for the photograph to be able to make good photos of the face of the archer while he's shooting. So it's more something for the press than actually for the archers. And as you can see here, some chairs. So that's where the referees, the judges will be sitting. If you have an ideal competition, you will have one judge for 8 targets. That's okay. But if you don't have enough judges, you can have one judge for 16 targets. Those judges are called line judges. They are responsible to see if the archers are behaving accordingly to the rules. They are also then responsible to walk over to the target faces with the archer. And if there is a doubt about scoring, the judges be called and the judge will give the definite score of that doubt arrow. We'll be just talking about that in a second. Beside what line judges, you have a table judge, which is responsible for the procedure of the competitions. He will announce when there is a break. He will announce how long will be the break. He will give the 2 signals for the archers to move from this line here over to the shooting line. And then there will be a signal one signal for starting shooting and a triple signal for stopping shooting. So you have three signals in target archery. Two signals to go on the shooting line, one signal, which is after 10 seconds after it was giving the two signals to start shooting. Then you have 4 minutes to shoot your six arrows, and then there will be three signals or multiple signals for you to stop. It can happen that during a competition, suddenly some crazy person just decides to cross running the field. People say, hey, never happens. It did happen. I already seen it happen a couple, I think it's 5 times I've seen that happen. People crossing the archery field, making some funny stuff. I saw some people running behind the butts and hiding behind the butts. I saw someone chasing his dog, which went on the field. Things happen. So the judge on the table judge, he must be attentive and he must check that. And he will whistle three or more multiple times. In the moment he does that, all archers must stop shooting. Don't worry, you will be allowed to have 40 seconds for each arrow you haven't shot. So you will have enough time afterwards to complete your session, to complete all your six arrows. This time will be given to you in such a case. So here we have the table judge, as you can see. The table judge in a position where he can see the entire shooting line and what's happening in this shooting line. Besides the table judge, you have a second judge who will be writing down everything that's happened during the competition. And then you have a chief judge of the competition. So a couple big group of judges to do an official competition. Those are tents, support area for equipment and stuff like that. This here is now just in the shooting line. As you can see, targets on the back, the number, the guiding lines for help, the 3 meter line. When you do a competition, FITA competition, you have the individual competition and you have team competition. A team competition is put up out of three archers. Official, big official competitions like world ranking events and World Cup, a country is allowed to take 4 archers. But only 3 of those 4 will make up a team. So the coach has 2 possibilities. He says nothing, and the organizing committee of this competition will automatically take the 3 best archers and put them in the team of that country. Or 10 minutes before starting the classification round, the coach goes to the judge table and puts them a paper where are written the name of the 3 archers which will make up that team. So 2 possibilities. Now let's see this picture. We see here a coach. He's standing at the wrong line. You see, this here is a press area. So he is not supposed to stand here. He needs to stand a little more far back here. The coach is allowed to talk to the archers in a way that he will not disturb other archers. But the archer is not allowed to talk back to the coach. That's rule. Not always happens so. Sometimes you see archers talking back to the coach and the judge standing there and saying nothing. Happens in 2009 during the Youth World Championship. The Korean archers were just talking back and forth with the coach. I asked the judge, is that okay? Because my archer was standing, shooting at the same line as a Korean archer. She just looked at me, lifted her shoulders like that and said, what can I do? They don't understand English. I mean, okay, that's not the answer I wanted to hear. But sciences was not disturbing my archer. I didn't care about it. But actually, that's not okay. rules should be applied to everyone. I'm quite sure if my archer would be talking to me, I would have gotten an advertisement. So, for you just to know, if you have an archer on the shooting line, the other archer from another team is talking back to his coach, and this is disturbing your archer, you do can complain, and you have the right to complain. Here we have another case, is during competition, the coach is standing together with the archers. That's not allowed. This coach is not allowed to stand together with the archers. So he must go all the way back, just must go in there. The only moment where the coach can stand together with the archers is when it's a warm-up session. Or when it's a warm in the first, when you start a competition, you always start with a 45-minute warm-up session. Or depending on the organizer of the competition, he can say, okay, it will be 4 rounds warm-up session at the longest distance. So in this case, the coach can stay together with the archers, and only on this case. Here we have a team event where you have 3 archers and the coach. Usually there is like a square here in the back that's a place for the coach. By the rules, as far as I know, the coach is not allowed to have a scope or anything. The scope stays with the archers, one of those archers. We will call the score to their mates. In a team event, you shoot 6 arrows in 2 minutes. So each archer moves into the line, shooting line, shoots 2 arrows, must move completely out of this 1 meter space here before the other archer moves into the line to shoot, in this case, her 2 arrows. And then she moves all the way for the third archer to move in. The arrow can only be taken out of the quiver when the archer reaches this shooting line. If it happens before, the judge will give an advertisement and the archer must go back and forth. So she will lose a lot of time. At the Olympic Games 2012, when you see the finals team match event, the scope was with the coach and the archers had no scope whatsoever. I think there was a change of rules just to make it for media, for video, for television, nicer to film the archers while they're waiting for their turn to shoot. So, but at world competition, at least the last ones I know, coach has no scope, scope stays with the archers. So, one of the big problems on world archery and FITA competitions and FITA rules, they change every year. And, well, that's again a little difficult. Here you have the judges standing, the coaches nicely back behind that line, and here the equipment of the archers and the archers went forward to pick up the arrows and count their scores. During competition, there should be like a time sign to help the archers to know how much time is still left to shoot. On this case, this time sign, it's not official time. A lot of archers think that this is official time. In a big competition, the table judge has his watch, and that's the official watch for the shooting time. This sign is just an help, an indication. So don't trust it, okay? It's just an indication. This sign may be faster or maybe slower than the actual watch of the table judge. Many, many places, they don't take that in account and use this year as an official sign for time and so on. But actually, by the rule, it's not. The sign below, here again the target. So we were talking about in FITA, when you shoot an arrow, You cannot replace that arrow. What happens if an arrow bounces off? It hits a target and bounces off, or it gets through the target. Sometimes the target's kind of a little old and the arrow just gets through the target. So while you're shooting, you must mark. So you will mark this target. Just a second. You will mark the target with a marker. It can be a line, it can be a double line. There are a lot of different ways to mark the targets. So let's put it here. Let's see, let's say we have, let's just get a pen here, eraser, sorry, oops. Crayon. Okay, we have, come on. That's a big, oh, it takes a long time. Okay, let's say that's a round target. And here you got your arrow. So you will mark like this. Or here you got your arrow, you will mark like this here. That's ideal. You have a lot of people marking like this here. I saw some people in India marking like painting around the hole. Right will be just one strip or an L to the... This is very important, because if there's a second arrow here, you know this was marked and this was not marked. That's very important to keep that in mind, that you do need to mark the holes. Why? And that's, we go back here to this here. You see this hole here? That's a hole which is not marked. Let's say this archer shot an arrow, it hit yellow and bounced it off. The judge will come look at non-marked spots, and the lowest non-marked spot will be your score. So even so, you know exactly you hit yellow, but that's a non-marked hole on 2 or 1, you will get that score 2 or 1. So be aware to mark all holes. The same counts for an arrow that gets through. When an arrow gets through, the first thing is to look where is a non-marked hole. Then check if it's possible that that arrow went through, which is depends on how far away that arrow is from the target. If an arrow is just on the bottom of the target, it's impossible for that arrow to have been gone through the target. Or if the arrow is all the way in the back, it's also not possible, because the arrow gets through, loses poundage, loses power, and it will just fall short behind the target. So all those things the judge will check, and then the judge will tell the score. Another thing, let's say you just did your scores. 1 second here. Oops. No. Okay, let's say you did you are unsure about a score. I'm just looking for a target here. You're just unsure about a score. You think it's just hitting the line. You think it's 10. And the other archer on the shooting line says it's not 10, it's 9. And there's arguing, you cannot come to a consensus or decision, so you call the judge. When you call the judge, many archers make a big mistake. They say, judge, is this arrow a 10? By the new rules, the judge can give you a miss on that question. You should never ask that. You should ask, what is the score of this arrow? That's the right question to do. And don't touch the arrow. If you touch the arrow, this arrow is automatically a miss. So don't touch the arrow and don't ask the judge, is this a 10 or is this a 9 or whatever. You just must point at the arrow you want to be judged, and say, "Judge, please tell me the score of this arrow," without touching the arrow. So I hope those are very clear and important things to be aware of. Another thing that you must be as an archer aware of is when you begin to shoot, there will be two sounds to go to the shooting line. You are not allowed to draw your bow during those two signs. You're not allowed to shoot. You must wait until they give the one sound. Then you can draw your bow and you can shoot. And you have 4 minutes. In a moment, it gives the triple sound. The beginning of the triple sound means it's the end of the time. Some archer said, "I just shot when the first sound of the triple sound ended." Sorry, too late. You lost that arrow. It's a miss. You just did not shot one arrow. And if this arrow hits a 10, unfortunately, your highest arrow. No, let's say different. Let's say you shot an arrow. You shot your last arrow after the first of the three sounds came up and it went a 2. Then your highest arrow will be a miss. Let's say you shot 10, 10, 9, 8, 8, 2. And 2 was your last arrow you shot after it finished those 4 minutes. The judge will go to your target and will take out your highest score. He will take out a 10. So don't shoot after thinking you'll be very clever, you'll be very smart, because you only will lose. Those rules are just to avoid people to shoot beyond the time. Another thing as an archer you should be taking care of is looking in the scope. You should not be the last in the line to look in the scope. That's why I tell all my archers, the sixth, the last arrow, don't look. Even if you're a fast shooter, don't look your last arrow in the scope. Because if you are the last archer in the shooting line, look in the scope, you get an advertisement. The reason is not to extend that competition unnecessarily. So sometimes all archers are after 3 minutes finished and all away from the shooting line. So the judge just can call out and everybody walks over to the target to get their scores and their arrows. So just not to avoid extending the competition unnecessarily, they say last archer in the shooting line is not allowed to look his last arrow on the scope. Try to avoid that. Actually, those are the major topics you must be aware of when you do target archery, and as a coach, also aware what you are allowed to do and what other coaches must be and where you can bring in a complaint. So, archery fields can be of major different makes. This year, as you can see, it's a native grass, it's a live grass, not synthetic grass, but you can have, you can shoot, as we can see here, one moment, you can shoot on top of the grass, that's the shooting line, but you also can have some places which will have a nice cement shooting line. That's my field here in Brazil. You can, in Venezuela, have a fantastic, beautiful archery range for major competition, and this year it's all cement. We put cement for the wheelchair archers, for them to have it more comfortable to move around. Before we had the cement, we had like pebbles here, so you also can have that. So shooting ranges can be of most diverse makes and forms. Also, archers are not allowed to shoot from below a covered place. So you must be in open space. If you have a covered place like this here, just 1/2 meter away from the shooting line, it's okay. But it is not allowed to cover and protect those archers from sunshine and rain. Archers, outdoor target archery is an outdoor event. So under sun and under rain, rainy conditions. Here again, we have like a reference line made out of chalk. You can have it like a rope or a marker. We just had your chalk. It was easier and more and cheaper for us. Or you can paint. Sometimes we paint it with white paint. Again, here we have para archers shooting among able archers. But about para, we just will come just in a second. Here we have another field. It was a Brazilian 2012 Nationals. It's like a field on the sand, on the beach. Okay? So it does not need to be always grass or whatever. It can be different areas, different places. It was a really beautiful competition. Hot, really hot, but just gorgeous. And we just were living in this apartment, you're just staying in this hotel on the 22nd floor, I think so, something like that, pretty high, and had a really beautiful sight of the entire archery range here, archery field, and during the competitions. So we have here the Masters event we had. They are shooting, I think here it's, let's see, 50 meters now. They are compound shooters, master compound shooters, shooting all at 50 meters. As you can see here, we have four targets in each of those lanes. Ideal would be one reference line for every two targets. Well, here they did it every four targets. Okay, it also works. Here we have the compound shooters and here some recurve shooters. Here we have the shooting line. As you can see, shooting line, the judge, an archer, the scopes must be below armpit. It's very important. If it's not, the judge will come and give an advertisement. It's unnecessary to get an advertisement, and by the rule, a judge after the third advertisement can take that archer out of the shooting line and competition has finished for that archer. Here we have the equipment line. Actually, this equipment line should be all the way in the back here, and here should be a line for the press, but due to the lack of space we had here, so it was not possible to put that equipment line, all the equipment all way back here, and so it was just improvised and put it up here. So you can see, even the rules are not that strict. There's certain flexibility on the rules. The important is that the competition goes on and that the distances are okay, that the shooting line is okay, and the time is in order, and equipment inspection is okay, so everyone will be shooting in the rules of the equipment. About equipment, it's a really interesting thing. Chest protector, which is in recurve archery, this here what you have here, he has a chest protector here, which has objective to avoid that the string of the recurve bow, usually only recurve bows have a chest protector, that the string doesn't get tangled in your t-shirt and so give you a bad shot. It's not an obligation. You are allowed to have it or not to have it. The same counts for arm protection. Here you have arm guard, how do they call it? It's free. You're not obliged to have it. The same is a tab. Tab is also not an obligation. There are certain rules for tabs, how they can be, but there's not obligation. Those are additions. You can have it or you don't need to have it. When you shoot compound bows, there's a maximum poundage, which is 60 pounds. if you shoot, just in a comparison, IFAa field archery, you have not the maximum poundage, but you have a maximum bow speed, which is 300 feet per second. So there's some small differences in rules, which are quite interesting to be aware of. The size of the scope, It's free, you can have any size. This competition, we had an A, B, C, D format of competition. So I just show you. You see, first group shooting, the second group waiting, the equipment of the second group. This first group stops shooting, you will move off to give space for the second group to shoot. In this photo, it's quite interesting. We have here Lucian with a para archer. So para archers are allowed to shoot able archery and para archery. So they can shoot in both type of competitions. And it's very advisable for them to shoot on both type of competitions. So Luciano, he shot a week earlier the para Brazilian competition, and then he shot the able Brazilian competition. In case of a para archer, he will not move away from the shooting line. So even this being A, B, C, D, in this case, Luciano is shooting A, the next archer is shooting B, the B archer will move away and be replaced by another archer, while Luciano stays put in this place. He will shoot four arrows and stay sitting and waiting until the other archer has finished shooting his six arrows. If it will be in a wheelchair, it will be exactly the same. The only difference between this here is the space that the para archer has. And we will talk about that just in a second. It's a beautiful shooting line here. As you can see, all targets line up to 70 meters. Then we have here, those signs are perfect, 100%. Those signs just touching the target face are not okay. You know, they should be a little higher. So you have the little flag, and here you have the watch to show you time. Okay, now we come into para archery. We just make a small break, and just in a couple seconds we will be talking about para archery. Okay, this was 2009 World Championship in Nymburk in Czech Republic. As you can see, this is another form of field. This is a synthetic grass, so competition was on a synthetic grass. It's a soccer field, and the same you see here, the numbers of the targets where the archers will be, and the numbers on the target with a little flag on the top. It was a really nice organized competition. On para archery, you will have maximum two para archers for each target. If you do a local competition, you can squeeze in three para archers, maybe one wheelchair and two standing, or just mix para archer with able archer. And then you will be able to squeeze three archers to shoot at one target. But actually, you will always have only two archers at each target. Here we have three para archers at the Brazilian 2012 Para Nationals. Here we have Francisco, he's a standing archer. Luciano, which is also a standing archer. That's one category of recurve. And then we have a W2, which Aldecir here, he's shooting W2 category. So recurve, it's divided in standing division and W2 division. Compound shooters will shoot all in one single division. That means compound open. So W2 and standing will be shooting against each other. And then besides standing, besides the recurve standing, recurve W2, compound open, you still have W1. It's another division. W1 are people with a more severe lesion, like a C2 or 3-1 lesion or double amputations. They will shoot a compound bow in the same style as you will be shooting a recurve bow. So with a recurve sight, without a trigger, but you can shoot a compound bow with wheels and so on. That's W1 division. What will classify you if you shoot standing or if you are allowed to shoot on a chair is your classification. So each para archer undergoes a classification. If you get 15 points disability, you are able to shoot in para category, understanding, like he's shooting standing. If you have 35 points or more, you are allowed to shoot sitting. Someone who's shooting sitting, he has a space of 80 centimeters times 60 for his chair and for his space of shooting. If you have above 51 points disability, then you are allowed to shoot on a wheelchair. And a wheelchair has a 120 centimeter space. The line, as you can see, on the wheelchair must go in between the two wheels. That means always will be 1 foot on one side of the shooting line, another foot on the other side, or one wheel on one side, the other wheel on the other side. All other rules are identical for para archery as for able archery. Rules of distances, equipment, 3 meter line, shooting times, 6 minutes four minutes for six arrows, everything is equal. Elimination rounds, for recurve, set rounds, for compound, continuous score up to 15 arrows, identical, same size of targets, everything is identical for recurve, for able, and for para archery. The only difference is the way they shoot, sitting or not sitting, the classification as a para archer, and the space they have available. In this case here, as you can see, we had three archers dividing one target because there was not too much targets available, so that those archers were just squeezed in. It's possible, but official rules are two archers for one target. Here again, we have archers shooting. Here's a compound archer shooting in a sitting position, another compound archer shooting on a wheelchair. Then we have a compound archer standing. So this here is an open division for compound. They all shoot against each other. Gents, one. Ladies, another one. Another year, a couple of para archers against, what I just said, wheelchair, standing, and so on. Here we have the field of the para world championship. As you can see, the line for press, equipment area, the coach will stand here, the archers will stand here. Here, archers just getting a warm up. Support team, those people in yellow, were support team. What happened? If you have a para archer event, or you have any able event, and there are para archers participating, and they have the right to do so, the organizer is obliged to have someone to help this para archer get his arrows and score. So if you have someone on a wheelchair or with a bigger disability and is not able to walk all the way to the target, then this person can name someone to do it for him. So it can be the coach, it can be another archer, or it can be a volunteer or someone from the organizing committee. One. If you're an able archer, if you're not a par, if you're an able archer, you also can ask your coach to go all the way to pick up your arrows. A coach is never allowed on able archery to walk with his archer all the way to the butt to get arrows. He's not allowed to do so. And also, if you have a para archer who can walk, the coach cannot just walk beside that para archer into the archery field to check arrows, to check score. That's not allowed to. But he can replace the archer. One thing an archer should always be aware, if you're not able to get your arrows, be whatever reason, you are a para archer, or you are able archer and you got pain in your leg, or you need to do some equipment check because you saw something happening with your bow, and you ask someone to go for you. Whatever this person does, it counts. Let's say you ask someone to check your scores and get your arrows, and that person just counts your arrows wrong. Maybe you did a 10-10-9 and just he didn't pay attention, and he will count it 10-9-8 or 10-9-9. So you will lose score. That counts because that person was in your place. He was replacing you. So whatever that person says and does and makes, it counts. If that person has no idea, he just comes to the target and pulls the arrows before they were counted. An arrow cannot be touched until it's been counted. So if he pulls the arrow before, it gets M. During this competition here, the Turkish team, the coach, just went forward, didn't pay attention, he forgot to count the arrows and pull the six arrows of his archers, of his archer, out of the target without counting it. And was just moving back. And when he was moving back, he realized, hey, I did not count my arrows. So he went back to the judge and asked the judge if he could count those arrows. And the judge made a big mistake. He just thought, well, poor para archer, let him. And he went back to the butt and checked where could have been the holes of those arrows and gave that score to that coach. When the Italian team saw that, they went into with a complaint. What happened? Those six arrows are M's. Absolutely no way to accept to count that. And that judge was off the competition because he made a huge, major mistake. So whenever you ask someone to do it for you, be aware and be certain that that person knows what he or she's supposed to do, because whatever mistake he or she does counts for real as if it were your own mistake. So usually when you have a big archery competition, you will have a main field for shooting and then you have a second field for warm up. In this case, this second field is not a warm up field, it's just a ladies field. So the ladies were shooting here. Sometimes on competitions like recurve or compound, or like compound, they shoot in the morning, the ladies shoot maybe in the afternoon. Those ladies want to make a warm up in the morning. If it's a big event and you have enough space, it's very advisable, if it's possible, to have an extra place, an extra field where people can do warm up. Not always will find that. When you do recurve FITA round, you will be in the morning doing the long distances. So you will have a warm-up session of 45 minutes before it starts shooting the longest distance. And then you shoot your 72 arrows. Then you have a lunch break. For the afternoon shooting, for the short distances, there is no warm-up session. So some places have an extra place where archers, before the short distance starts, they can go there to give some shots. At those places, the butts are not allowed to have a target and they are not allowed to be at an official distance. So usually will be something around 50 meters or 20 meters for archer not to get his side tested and straightened up. It was one of the Brazilian competitions. Was an archer during the 70 meters. He had a problem with his scope. I think it was a compound archer. He had a problem with his scope. And it was a compound archer. He had a problem with his scope at 70 meters. And I think his knock point just went off or something like that. Happens a problem. So he just went fix it and asked the judge if he could just test out and on the free time, the lunch time, he went on the field and shot at 70 meters because the judge said, you are allowed to do that. So he shot a couple arrows just to get his sight back in order. The adversary saw it, went into a complaint, wanting to throw that archer out of the competition. It was not possible. The archer kept in the competition, but the judge who allowed the archer to do that was taking off because that was a major mistake. So when the field is closed, no archer can shoot at the shooting field. Therefore, you have a warm-up field or warm-up place with a distance which is not official, that has absolutely no target on it, just a butt. Field, shooting field is only during competition. If it's closed, you are not allowed. Well, competition finished, let's say 4:30 in the afternoon, at 8 o'clock is still kind of light. You are not, you're somewhere in Germany in the summer, so it's light up to 10 o'clock at night. I'm going to shoot a couple of arrows at that field. If you have no authorization, you will be disqualified from the competition. If you have an authorization, some of the judges said, yes, you can do it, go ahead, do it. This judge is off the competition too. So it's not allowed to. Be very careful about that. Here we have some nice pics of para archers, the amount of para archers together, it's impressive. And we are back here. So I hope you enjoy it. I hope it helps you a little further. And for those who are not target archers, are more field archers and IFAa field archers, I hope they got a little an insight about what is target archery and the main rules and things you must watch and take care of. Thank you for watching.